The New Adventures of Batman is a television series that originally aired on the CBS network in the year 1977. Even though the Filmation-produced animated series is a follow-up to The Adventures of Batman that aired as part of the Batman-Superman Hour in the late 1960s, Olin Soll and Casey Kasem did not actually end up reprising their roles as the Caped Crusaders. This is because Hanna-Barbera and the ABC network were currently producing the Super Friends animated series and had already procured the services of Olin Soll and Casey Kasem as Batman and Robin on their cartoon series. So Filmation ended up having Adam West and Burt Ward, the actors from the live-action Batman series, reprise their roles, albeit in animated form.
Why are you doing this, Batman?
Two reasons. Wealth and power.
The bat tools of the trade, such as the bat computer, batmobile, bat poles, bat boat, bat gyros, and bat plane, all make appearances. On the television series, the bat gyros tend to remind me more of whirly bats that simply eject from the seats of the batmobile. The Batplane could also transform into a submarine when the dynamic duo is in pursuit of the undersea villain Professor Bubbles. The first time the Batplane is modified to serve as a bat submarine is within the pages of World's Finest Comics issue number 25 by the year 1946. The Batplane 2 from Batman issue number 61 also has the same capabilities, even though by Batman issue number 86, the Caped Crusader had a standalone vehicle called the Batmarine.
Super submerging submarine, Batman!
Although the faithful Wayne Butler Alfred never actually shows up on this series, other members of the familiar Batman supporting cast would reappear, such as Commissioner Gordon and his daughter, Barbara Gordon, also known as Batgirl. In her prior appearances on television, Barbara Gordon serves as a Gotham City librarian. Barbara's new occupation by the time of the follow-up Filmation cartoon is that of the assistant district attorney. This actually brings to mind her stint as an elected official to the Congress of the United States that began in the pages of Detective Comics issue 422 by the year 1972. As a member of Congress, Gordon even goes on a brief date with Clark Kent in the 1973 story titled Wild Weekend in Washington from Superman issue number 268. Eventually, her term would come to an end, and she would lose her bid for re-election inside the pages of Detective Comics issue 487 by 1979.
Actually, I was thinking of Batgirl.
No, this is far too big for her.
Oh, come on, Dad. Batgirl can do anything Batman can.
Also on the previous television series, Barbara Gordon's crime-fighting identity as Batgirl remained a secret from the dynamic duo. But this, too, would change with the airing of The New Adventures of Batman. Just as Robin and Batgirl would learn one another's secret identities when Dick Grayson worked as an aide for Representative Barbara Gordon in the pages of Batman Family issue number 3 by the year 1976, it's pretty obvious from a couple of key exchanges that the cat was out of the bag on the 1977 television series as well. Batgirl and Robin even shared their very first kiss inside the pages of Batman Family issue number 1 a few years earlier.
I'll give it to you as soon as I change into Batgirl.
Speaking of kisses, Batgirl is frequently seen giving them to the brand new supporting Batman cast member called Batmite. The infatuation that the magical imp has with Batgirl is fairly similar to his relationship with Batwoman, a one-time partner of his in the pages of Batman issue 133.
I'm in love!
Of course, Batmite himself tends to be rather indiscriminate with who he kisses.
So there you are! Thank goodness I found you!
Greetings, Dynamic Duo! I'm your biggest fan!
What is it?
I just want to help! Just wanna help!
Oh, I wanna had to do was help.
Batmite, who is akin to Superman's own Mr. Mitzelplick, first appears inside the pages of Detective Comics issue 267 by the year 1959. The main difference between the two characters is that while Batmite may cause some mischief, he usually doesn't do so intentionally and is only really trying to help. Of course, Batman and Robin usually need his help like they need a hole in the head.
Holy delays, Batmite! You're holding us up!
He's holding me back!
Mitzelplick and Batmite first meet in the pages of World's Finest Comics issue 113 by the year 1960, and the terrible team would reunite to bedevil Superman and Batman again in World's Finest Comics issue 123. However, a personal favorite comic of mine would have to be Batman 158. This was one of the earliest and oldest back issues I would own of the ongoing Batman series during my youth. The story, from 1963, reveals that Batmite is the one who gives Ace the Bat-Hound these crazy and outlandish superpowers.
Whose side is he on anyway?
I don't know, but he's wearing our colors.
On the television series, Batmite is said to have originated from the dimension Ergo. However, given his strong ties to Mitzelplick in the comics, many have speculated that he probably comes from Zriff, or the fifth dimension, just like Mitzelplick. Although, if you go by World's Finest Comics issue 152, it would seem to suggest that the two imps come from completely separate dimensions. Since the bumbling, magically powered imp is voiced by Lou Scheimer, it's not hard to see the influence Batmite must have had on Orko from He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. The two are both well-meaning and good-hearted, but their powers often make a mess of things for the Caped Crusader or the most powerful man in the universe. In the comic book stories, such as World's Funnest, both Mitzelplick and Batmite seem to have unlimited omnipotence. Although on the TV series, Batmite tended to get tripped up rather easily, much like Orko. And it's even suggested that the alloy steel prevents Batmite from using his abilities properly.
Go ahead and laugh. I'm going to warn Batman and Robin, you'll see! Uh-oh. I forgot. Steel is the one thing that stops me.
I ain't got no problem.
Oh, yes, you do.
Batmite would go on to appear in a multitude of episodes on the animated series Batman Brave and the Bold, voiced by Pee-wee Herman himself, Paul Reubens. There's also a terrific nod to Batmite on the television series Teen Titans. In the season 2 episode titled Fractured, there's a magical imp pestering the Titans whose fifth dimensional name is actually Dick Grayson spelled backwards. Beast Boy makes it easy on us all and decides to give the homage the nickname of Larry.
Nazika. maybe we should just call you Larry.
My name is Larry now! Yay!
Larry!
Mr. Larry! Larry! Hey, Larry! Hi! How you doing, Larry? Larry!
Larry!
Larry! Hey, Larry! Hi! How you doing, Larry? Larry!
Batmite's arch-nemesis on the television series would be the evil imp known as Zarbor. Zarbor kinda looks like a huge genie from Aladdin's lamp, but in this case, he conscripts the villains of Gotham City to help him destroy Batman and Robin in the two-part episode titled Have an Evil Day. The Caped Crusaders first encounter Zarbor because he decides to travel to Earth from his home dimension of Ergo via starship.
Excuse me.
It will carry my power to every corner of creation.
Excuse me, I'd just like to ask a question. What does God need with a starship?
Eventually, Batman, Robin, and Batmite have to follow Zarbor back to Ergo to prevent him from taking over the entire planet. You might think Batman traveling to alien planets or dimensions is out of the ordinary, but there are plenty of tales from the Silver Age of comics, such as Robin Dies at Dawn in Batman 156. These all too bizarre cases would find themselves detailed within the Dark Knight's Black Case book, as detailed in Grant Morrison's RIP storyline. mind. Along with the Gotham villains, Zarbor is assisted by a servant robot called Chug, who reminds me of an evil version of Herbie the Robot from the Fantastic Four. Chug seems desperate for fuel and serves Zarbor for the promise of rich sources of energy. There's actually this weird parallel between the 1973 oil crisis, or maybe the 1979 energy crisis, as we come to discover there's actually a similar energy crisis facing the planet Ergo. Of course, if one would question a magical imp's use of a starship, then I'd also have to wonder what the hell they need with nuclear energy as well.
Now me, Zarbor! Now me! I get a shot of that energy too! Remember? Remember?
Go away, Chug. I no longer have need for you.
But, Zarbor, you promised!
There are several other villains on the TV series that were original to the Filmation series. Sort of like a nefarious version of Willy Wonka, the criminal Sweet Tooth plots to ruin Gotham City's water supply by replacing it with chocolate. If you blink, you may miss him, but Sweet Tooth indeed makes a follow-up appearance a whopping 33 years later in the Batman Brave and the Bold episode titled A Bat Divided. Initially, the villain called the Chameleon gave me the impression that this is what could happen if Eel O'Brien continued to pursue his criminal ways. Rather than being a master of disguise, like the Spider-Man villain of the same name, the Chameleon on the Filmation television series can alter his shape into a variety of forms, stretching and elongating his arms like Plastic Man, or morphing into a rocket much like She-Ra's arch-nemesis Hordak. Eventually, the Chameleon is revealed to be a robotic battlesuit for the hidden operator named Dr. Devious.
It's all over, Chameleon. I figured out your secret. There's only one way you could do all the things you do. You're a robot!
It's a Transformer!
The final original Filmation villain also shares a name with an existing Spider-Man foe called Electro. Insipidly, this version of Electro has absolutely nothing to do with electricity and is more like Batman's Brainiac than Max Dillon. Electro's first officer on his spaceship does indeed have a green hue, so, you know, who's to say he couldn't be related to the Man of Steel's computerized nemesis? Electro does end up using a shrink ray on the dynamic duo, just like Brainiac uses one on the citizens of the former Kryptonian capital city of Kandor, or Superman and Lois Lane.
Don't try anything foolish, Commissioner. And tell your men to keep their distance, or I'll put all of Gotham City in a bottle.
You may even think that the character of the Moon Man is an original Filmation creation, but you'd be wrong. Moon Man actually first appears within the pages of World's Finest Comics issue number 98 by the year 1958. In the story titled The Menace of the Moon Man, astronaut Scott Rogers fights both Superman and Batman when he succumbs to the transformative powers of the moonlight after being altered by a kryptonite-powered comet. The Filmation TV series would abandon the kryptonite aspect of the Moon Man's origins, but retains Rogers' friendship with the Caped Crusaders by saying that he and Bruce Wayne were roommates in college together. The series also preserved the process by which the moonlight turns the unsuspecting astronaut into an alien villain. Although it would take place 15 years later, inside the pages of Amazing Spider-Man, the Moon Man's modus operandi reminds me of the circumstances behind the transformation of astronaut John Jameson into the creature called Man-Wolf. While the effects of the moonlight in World's Finest Comics turned out to have only a temporary effect on Scott Rogers, on the television series, Batman is forced to negate the moon's effects on his close friend.
But you can't just turn off the moon!
Oh, yes, we can!
Yeah. The moon. They need the moon!
Scott Rogers also brings to mind another close friend of Bruce Wayne's from the series The Batman. Ethan Bennett is a member of the Gotham City Police Department who is eventually transformed by the Blanca Joker's putty in a subsequent animated series titled The Batman. The transformation leaves Bennett with the newfound ability to alter his shape, after which he becomes known as the villain Clayface. While Ethan Bennett is a character created exclusively for that particular Batman television series, the Clayface known as as Matt Hagen does indeed originate from the comics themselves, and The New Adventures of Batman from Filmation marks his first appearance on television. Matt Hagen first appears within the pages of Detective Comics issue number 298 by the year 1961.
Matt Hagen, otherwise known as Clayface.
Clayface? Of course!
Hagen gains his awesome powers as a result of the strange substance he discovers while diving for sunken treasure. If Hagen does not expose himself to his secret pond every 48 hours, he will revert back into his normal human form. Clayface would frequently shapeshift into existing animals or chimera hybrids in his original appearance. With the exception of disguising himself as Batman in the episode Dead Ringers, Clayface mostly assumed the shapes of a variety of wildlife creatures on the Filmation series as well. Clayface would transform into everything imaginable, from gorillas, eagles, serpents, and rabbits, to dolphins and Jaws-inspired sharks. Detective Comics issue 304 from the year 1962 would also see Hagen as a great white shark. In the episode Curses Oiled Again, Hagen teams up with Catwoman to hoard the world's oil so they can drive up the prices to fill their own pockets. I don't have very much to say in regard to Catwoman in this series other than the fact that her character design is pretty awful and looks like something that Catman might wear. Even though they start out as allies, eventually Catwoman leaves Hagen behind, attempting to escape the justice of the Caped Crusaders in her cat missile.
Sorry, Clayface, but now it's every woman for herself.
No! Wait!
One of the individuals who had come to be known as Clayface started out as a nemesis of Catwoman in her 2002 ongoing series. This particular Clayface's backstory involves being a military test subject. His true name remains a mystery, but for some reason the internet has dubbed him Todd Russell after the identity of a suave movie star that he impersonates in Catwoman Volume 3, Issue Number 3. Although his comic debut gave him the somewhat freaky Tetsuo-like appearance of twisted malleable flesh by issue 45 of Catwoman's ongoing series, he later appears to look like most traditional looking clay faces. Believe it or not, there have actually been 9 separate individuals who have all gone by the name Clayface over the years. The very first Clayface is known as Basil Carlo, which is a play on the names of real-life actors Boris Karloff and Basil Rathbone. Basil Carlo first appears inside the pages of Detective Comics issue 40 in the year 1940. Turns out myself and Carlo have a strong dislike of remakes in common. However, Carlo becomes a disgruntled actor turned serial killer, pulling some kind of Phantom of the Opera act that carries over into his real life when the movie that put him on the map is remade. The Matt Hagen character, in the excellent 2-part Batman the Animated Series episode titled Feet of Clay, incorporated the actorly aspects of Basil Carlo in a gripping tale of tragedy and revenge. Initially in the comics, Basil Carlo possessed no shape-shifting abilities whatsoever. Those traits only began with the Matt Hagen version in 1961. The Hagen Clayface would eventually meet his demise in the DC mega event, Crisis on Infinite Earths. The Hagen Clayface would later return to Batman the Animated Series in the episodes titled Mudslide, as well as Growing Pains and the Christmas episode Holiday Nights. He also went on to serve as a member of Gorilla Grodd's Secret Society of Supervillains in the follow-up Justice League animated series. Most recently, Hagen's Clayface can be seen in the Young Justice episode titled Downtime, providing the young heroes quite the challenge until Batman swoops in to save the day.
What are you doing?
stop it!
After Hagen's death in Crisis on Infinite Earths, the character Preston Payne is introduced in Detective Comics issue 478 by the year 1978. Payne attempted to replicate Hagen's morphing gifts by injecting himself with a formula created from Hagen's blood samples. But instead, his efforts left him disfigured and trapped in a supportive exoskeleton. Now, Payne is compelled to touch the skin of non-infected victims to alleviate his own pain, leaving them blobs of protoplasm. In the Batman the Brave and the Bold episode, Joker, the Vile and the Villainous, while at the Z-list villain hangout called the 8 Bar, you can clearly see a portrait of the Preston Payne version of Clayface hanging up on the wall. Payne would eventually find some modicum of happiness when he became introduced to Lady Clayface and they began a relationship. Lady Clayface, also known as Sandra Fuller, first appears as a member of Cobra's Strike Force in the pages of The Outsiders, issue number 21, by the year 1987.
You know something, Robs? Crime does pay.
One of my favorite Batman stories ever, called Mud Pack, ran through Detective Comics issues 604 to 607 in the year 1989. Carlo had returned and brought together all the existing Clayfaces to date, including the remains of Matt Hagen. Ultimately, Carlo has himself injected with blood samples from all three of the powered Clayfaces so he might have their combined ability. But the ultimate Clayface is finally defeated by Batman and his former teammate from The Outsiders called Looker. Unfortunately, the only version of Looker appearing on film to date is from the direct-to-video feature Justice League Crisis on Two Earths. In the film, she's an evil mirror double of the actual hero, serving as part of Owlman's crime syndicate team, calling herself Model Citizen.
I don't want to fight you. I want to...
Hey, this is like the Jedi mind trick.
This is not like the Jedi mind trick.
The Batman episode, titled Clayfaces, introduces its very own version of Basil Carlo into the series. Here, Carlo is a significantly less talented actor than the original comics version. This is readily apparent when he uses the Clayface formula to provide himself a better-looking appearance, yet he still ends up botching the audition.
I think we've seen enough.
So, when do we start shooting?
I'm sorry, but you're just not right for the role.
Really? Because if my look is the problem, that I can change. I can even play the dog.
Following the events of the Mud Pack storyline, Sandra Fuller and Preston Payne have a child together who they named Cassius Clay Payne. He, too, would follow in his parents' footsteps, possessing trademark Clayface-like abilities in the pages of Shadow of the Bat, issue number 27, as of the year 1994. Interestingly enough, the father-son dynamic between Clayfaces is touched on again in the TV series Birds of Prey in the episode titled Feet of Clay. While this version combines aspects of all the previous Clayface's abilities, similar to the Preston Payne version, he has a son named Chris Cassius and thrives on the transference of pain to his victims.
That's why they couldn't find the killer. It was you. You're enjoying this.
Next, Dr. Peter Molly of the Department of Extranormal Operations would end up using the younger Payne as a test subject in experiments as of Batman 550 by the year 1998. Eventually, Molly is subjected to a sample harvested from Cassius that bonds with the scientist who becomes known as Claything. Last but not least, we have Johnny Williams, whose backstory is revealed within the pages of Gotham Knights from issues 68 to 71. Williams is a former fireman exposed to toxic chemicals on the job who is summarily used by the villain Hush in his second campaign against the Dark Knight Detective.
Who are you?
Ah, soon they forget. I am Clayface. I'm going to find out who you really are. And your career as a crime fighter will be over forever!
The Riddler and Scarecrow did not make return appearances on the show. This was because the rights to the characters were already locked up by Hanna-Barbera for the series Challenge of the Super Friends. Oddly enough, you can actually see the Riddler in the opening credits of The New Adventures of Batman, albeit in a red-colored costume. Conversely, while the Joker would be a returning villain on The New Adventures of Batman, legend has it that since his rights were tied to this Filmation series, that this prevented him from being a member in good standing of the Legion of Doom on Hanna-Barbera's Challenge of the Super Friends. Any red tape, legendary or otherwise, would be cut in the 2006 Alex Ross miniseries called Justice, which includes the Joker as a member of the Legion of Doom.
Well done, Giggles. That's a good hyena.
Giggles, the hyena, is a pet of the Joker's that is introduced on the Filmation TV series. Presumably the perfect companion to the cackling clown prince of crime, this spotted hyena accompanies the Joker in the episodes The Pest as well as He Who Laughs Last. The character of Giggles is paid tribute to in future television series with Harley's two so-called babies from the Batman the Animated Series episode called The Man Who Killed Batman. The babies would go on to appear in subsequent episodes of Batman the Animated Series, as well as making appearances on later seasons of The Batman. The two also serve as the archenemies of Ace the Bat-Hound on the animated series Crypto the Superdog. In a Red Sky episode of Batman the Animated Series titled Joker's Millions, we learn that they are named after the comedy team of Abbott and Costello.
Bud, Lou, our ship has come in, boys! We're gonna spend!
Mr. Freeze returns in the episode titled Deep Freeze, along with a new sidekick called Professor Frost. Here, Freeze is portrayed as an inept criminal who takes advantage of Frost's wit and planning to commit crimes in Gotham City. Compared to Freeze's prominence in the Filmation and Adam West Batman series, he was originally not a very frequent opponent of the Caped Crusader in the comic books. In fact, the character can be seen languishing in relative obscurity in the limbo of forgotten characters from Grant Morrison's Animal Man run until being returned to media prominence in the Batman the Animated Series episodes, Heart of Ice, and in a possible nod to the Filmation series, Deep Freeze.
That's right, buddy. Jail is one cooler I want no part of.
You are not sending me to the cooler.
The Penguin is the final member of Batman's rogues gallery that would return on The New Adventures of Batman. In the episode titled Reading, Writing, and Wronging, Penguin gets a bunch of delinquent kids together to apprentice them into a life of crime.
Well, here's another fine mess Penguin's got us into.
Well, here's another nice mess you've gotten me into.
Maybe this is a subconscious commentary on all who seek elected office, but for some reason, the Penguin is always, always cast in a role of a nefarious politician. In the episode, Birds of a Feather Fool Around Together, he runs a campaign against the Joker to be elected the president of the yearly Underworld Convention, or Yuck, as it's known for short. Before this, he could be seen running for mayor in the Adam West Batman series episodes titled His Honor the Penguin and Dishonor the Penguin. Post the Underworld election on the Filmation animated series, he would again be seen running for political office in Tim Burton's feature film Batman Returns.
Mr. Cobblepot, you are the coolest role model a young person could have.
And you're the hottest young person a role model could have. Here. Wear a button. Let me just get it on that.
Penguin, use this my kind of guy.
Yeah, keep up the bad work, Penguin, old pal.
Thank you.
Filmation again makes attempts to throw in a moral bat message at the conclusion of each episode, as they did in Shazam. Though I must admit, whoever came up with the majority of the messages must have been asleep at the wheel. I mean, oftentimes the bat computer screen flashes the term bat message over and over again, as if you were to have some kind of fortune cookie wisdom bestowed upon your person. While most are fairly simplistic and easy to understand, such as crime doesn't pay or talk over your problems, one could watch other ending sequences phrases repeatedly and still come back wondering what message is trying to be conveyed to the audience. You get the feeling that some of them weren't written so much with any particular message in mind, but just as a concluding moment of the episode. I mean, so they catch Batmite with a popsicle. I mean, what's the big deal? What exactly is the message here? That popsicles are the food of the devil or something? I just don't get it. Although hearing West and Ward instead of Soul and Kasem doing Batman and Robin takes a little getting used to, for the most part, this series will be enjoyable if you're a fan of Filmation or what folks might call a lighter version of Batman.
Well, look at it this way, Batman. You always wanted to learn how to surf, and I can't think of a better time than now.
Batman, how did you know about this?
Batman always knows.
In dress, he finds crime by night. Yeah, it's Batman and Robin, Boy Wonder at his side. Hey now, Riddler, Penguin, Joker, better go and hide. We need the Batman. We need the Batman.
Riddles are a superstitious, cowardly lot. So my disguise must be able to strike terror into their hearts.
Signal sweeps across the midnight sky. Somewhere in Gotham City, it'll find the Batman's eye. There's a crime wave going on, but not for very long, 'cause the Batman's gonna teach him right from wrong. They call him Batman. They call him Batman.
Just that strange car.
No, why?
It was shaped like a bat.
So when you see the Batmobile quickly pass you by, you know they've heard the bat phone and the commissioner's cry. Yeah, that dynamic duo's out to prove crime doesn't pay, and from the Batcave our heroes keep evil at bay. We need the Batman.
Black, terrible,
As if in answer, a huge bat flies in the open window.
A bat, that's it. It's an omen. I shall become a bat.
Thus is born this weird figure of the dark, this avenger of evil, the Batman.